How beautiful it is for brothers and sisters to fellowship together in Christ at the worship service such as this. On behalf of our resident minister and the leaders meeting, I welcome all of you. May God bless our fellowship and send you forward to service in this world. Amen. Shall we please continue our service as we take Methodist hymn book number 32. We sing all the stanzas. Shall we please? let's continue to ask for peace for this country. Gradually we are getting to election time. Lots of issues will crop up, disturbances here and there. But the good Lord is just and faithful that is asking to protect this country. Let's commit the president of the nation into the Lord's care. He is the leader. He decides. Let us also commit his cabinet into the Lord's care. All ministers of state, all state directors, directors in authority, members of parliament, district chief executives, let's commit all of them into the care of the Most High God, and every decision they take in the interest of this country shall go the positive way for Ghana to continue to enjoy the peace we have been enjoying. We continue to pray for the Church Universal, that the good Lord will continue to strengthen and empower us, even in this COVID-19 season. Worship becomes difficult, prayer becomes difficult for most of us. Most of us even fear coming to church, because we thought we might contract the disease from the church. Let's pray and ask God's intervention. Let's remember the Methodist Church of Ghana, the presiding bishop, the administrative bishop, the lay president, all the bishops of the various diocese. Let's pray for God's direction, that they will continue to shepherd the church, for the rekindling of the Holy Spirit. Let us not forget the Accra Diocese as well, and our bishop, Right Reverend Emisaiyisen, and his leaders. Let's also intercede on behalf of the John Secret, our superintendent minister, our second minister, the leaders meeting, all leaders of organizations, and all members of this church, for God's continual protection over their lives and over our lives, for good health, that they have not neglected their duties. They continue to protect us in prayer, continue to intercede on our behalf, even when we find it difficult to come to church on Sundays. Continue to sacrifice the calls, the visitations. Let's thank God for their lives. At this juncture, I'd like to commit the sick into the Lord's hands. Those of us here may be healthy physically, but spiritually we are sick, most of us. Let's commit ourselves into the Lord's care. And those who are physically weak in spirit, some have found themselves in the hospitals, some through no fault of theirs, let's remember them and ask for God's healing power. The Bible says, by his stripes we are healed. You can remember somebody, use somebody as a point of contact. Pray for all sick people. The afflicted. Let's not forget the employed, the unemployed as well. There are a lot of people roaming the streets of Accra and other cities looking for jobs. Well, there are virtually no jobs for them, which means they may go hungry or they go hungry. So when you can afford one square meal a day, please remind them or remember them in God's prayer, remember them in prayers and ask God for intervention. Those who are even employed, some do complain because the salaries are not enough. Let's not forget those who are mourning. families are mourning here, let's intercede on their behalf. Let's ask for God's power, God's consolation, the consolation of the Word of God. Maybe if it hasn't happened to you before, you may never know how it feels to lose a loved one.
Thank you.
open our hearts and minds by the power of the Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what the scriptures say. Amen. We take our readings.
Let me pray. Our first reading is taken from Genesis chapter 45, 1 to 15. Genesis 45, 1 to 15. I read from the Living Translation. Joseph could not stand no longer. There were many people in the room, and he said to his attendants, "Out, all of you." So he was alone with his brothers when he told them who he was. Then he broke down and wept. He wept so loudly Egyptians could hear him. And word of it quickly carried to Pharaoh's palace. "I am Joseph," he said to his brothers. "Is my father still alive?" But his brothers were speechless. They were stunned to realize that Joseph was standing there in front of them. "Please, come closer," he said to them. So they came closer. And he said again, "I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into slavery in Egypt. But don't be upset and don't be angry with yourselves for selling me to this place. It was God who sent me here ahead of you to preserve your lives. This famine that has ravaged the land for 2 years will last 5 more years, and there will be neither plowing nor harvesting. God has sent me here ahead of you to keep you and your families alive to preserve many survivors. So it was God who sent me here, not you." And he said, "And he is the one who made me an advisor to Pharaoh, the manager of his entire palace, and the governor of all Egypt. Now hurry back to my father and tell him, 'This is what your son Joseph says. God has made me master over all the land of Egypt. So come down to me immediately. You can live in the region of Goshen, where you can be near me with all your children and grandchildren, your flocks and herds, and everything you own. I will take care of you there, for there are still 5 years of famine ahead of us. Otherwise, you, your household, and all your animals will starve.' Then Joseph added, 'Look, you can see for yourselves, and so can my brother Benjamin, that I really am Joseph. Go tell my father of my honored position here in Egypt. Describe for him everything you have seen, and then bring my father here with him.' Weeping with joy, he embraced Benjamin, and Benjamin did the same. Then Joseph kissed each of his brothers and wept over them, and after that he began talking freely with him." The word of God.
Beloved, the second Bible reading is taken from Romans chapter 11, verse 1 and 2, and we continue from 29:32. Please, shall we listen to the word of God? "I ask them, did God reject his own people? Certainly not. I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people, whom he chose from the beginning. You know what the scripture says in the passage, why Elijah pleads with God against Israel. 29. For God does not change his mind about whom he chooses and blesses. As for you Gentiles, you disobeyed God in the past, but now you have received God's mercy because the Jews were to eat. In the same way, because of the mercy that you have received, The Jews now disobey Paul, in order that they also may now receive God's grace. For God has made all people prisoners of disobedience, so that he might show mercy to them all. Beloved, the word of God.
We thank you, Lord.
That is what defiles them. Then the disciples came to him and asked, "Do you know that the Pharisees were offended when they heard this?" He replied, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be pulled up by the roots. Leave them, they are blind guides. If the blind lead the blind, both will fall into a pit." Peter said, "Explain the parable to us." "Are you still so dull?" Jesus asked. "Don't you see that whatever enters the man goes into the stomach and then out of the body? But the things that come out of the person's mouth come from the heart, and these defile them. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, slander. These are what defile a person, but eating with unwashed hands does not defile them." Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite man from the vicinity came to him, crying out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly." Jesus did not answer a word. So his disciples came to him and asked him, "Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel." The woman came and knelt before him. "Lord, help me," she said. He replied, "It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." "Yes, it is, Lord," she said. "Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table." Then Jesus said to her, "Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted." And her daughter was healed at that moment. This is the word of God.
We take our sermon hymn from the Methodist hymn book number 238. "My faith looks up to thee." We take all four stanzas.
Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we want to thank you for the gift of life. We thank you that you have preserved us for yet another day. We thank you that it has pleased you to assemble in your house to listen to your word. We thank you, Father, for preserving our life in a time like this. I avail myself that I speak to your people through me. I don't have anything to give apart from what you have deposited in me. I avail myself as your own chosen instrument. Pray that the Holy Spirit will take absolute control over everything, so that at the end of it, when everything ends successfully, we shall have a cause to celebrate your goodness once again. I thank you for answering prayer. Amen.
Amen.
Bethany. I am very grateful to the clergy and the administration of the church for this opportunity to share the word of God with you. I have to make a confession. Indeed, when Superintendent Minister told me about it, I had earlier booked for an appointment with my doctor. I was supposed to visit the theater last Thursday. I didn't have the boldness to say it, but I threw a challenge to God. The miracle is that I was at the theater on Thursday, and today I stand here to preach the word of God. God has preserved my life for this. I'm very grateful to God for having preserved my life. We are going to talk about faith, and the theme is great faith rewards. Our text is from Matthew 15:28. It reads, "Dear woman," Jesus said to her, "your faith is great. Your request is granted." And her daughter was instantly healed. What do we mean when we talk about faith? I am not going to give any dictionary definition. I want it to be very practical. When we talk about faith, we are talking about believing in the one and only one supreme God who created the heavens and the earth. By faith, we are referring to the amount of confidence and degree of trust that we have in such a God. We are believing that he is the God of all gods and he has no substitute or opportunity. He is a God who is with us now. He was in existence as creation and created and owns everything. And he is also to come. He is the triune God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. We are also believing that he is omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent. By the mention of his name, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is God. And very often we are proud to be associated with the way this God related to and treated the fathers and mothers of faith, because that serves as a source of encouragement and motivation to us for this generation. We sometimes pride ourselves to have been descendants of Abraham because of the fact that Abraham remained obedient to God, served with God his life, and became a blessing unto me. The story about Joseph, which we read in Mark, reminds us about the challenges he went through, the kind of treatment he received from his own servants. Micah 7:6, that man's enemies are members of his own family. He really suffered from the hands of his own servants. Because he had faith in that God, God delivered him from all the various stages and made him a prime minister in the foreign land. Those who thought they could take advantage of you, they will see you next time in a different position, in a different situation, and they will begin to doubt whether that is really you or a different person. That is when you persist in the faith that you have in this God. We are also believing in a God who cannot be reduced to graceless and leprous and carried around places, around people's waist and people's waist. That is not the God we are talking about. We are talking about a God who cannot be confined to a pot or a bottle and kept under a bed. are talking about God who is the Spirit. What we read about Joseph was really a source of encouragement to us, because we realized that even in the midst of adversity, this God delivered. And when we read about Elijah's zeal for the Lord, God was made him to confront Elijah, who was a power worshiper and prophesied 3 years of doubt, and how God took care of him. We are not waiting. In a country where the constitution allows them to make special provision for prophets, if you are facing a challenge, if you are handicapped, and God will pass rivers which are on green beds to bring you food and meat, and God will put you by you, provide water for you, and when that is exhausted, He will make another provision for you through the weeding, the poor weeding. Then it tells us the story that it doesn't matter our circumstances, it doesn't matter the difficulties we are confronted with, it is in the midst of those challenges that God will bring a solution. When the Israelites sinned and they were beaten by venomous snakes on the wilderness, they were the same snake, brute snake, with them. They obeyed God's instructions to do that, and they were healed. So, yes, we are recovering. We are facing challenges, we are facing difficulties. That the God that I'm talking about is capable of taking care of us, is capable of providing for us, is capable of protecting us in this situation so that we come out victorious. That is the God that we are talking about. And if we really have faith in this God, our faith should manifest. Genuine faith has the ability and the strength to be beyond all the pains and suffering in this life and to hold on to eternity. Because without faith, the Christian faith has no, the Christian life has no foundation, for no one can please God without it. Hebrews 11:6-8. Therefore, our faith as delegates, if really genuine, should go beyond the clear recitation of the Apostles' Creed. Our motivation to inherit the God to eternity should encourage us in the time of global pandemic to continue to believe and trust in God who has saved us and brought us all this far. Our faith must manifest in our worship. And in a time like this, we should be able to come to worship the God that we serve. David said he was happy when he was told to be in the house of God. There was a preacher man in the COVID time, during the lockdown time, who said on the social media that he had observed that people who were naturally not from going to church were those who were making the most noise about the lockdown and how it had disrupted church programs. And he was waiting to see how he saved people in Parliament's church anytime the lockdown was lifted. I don't know whether the same situation applies to us, because it seems to be that despite all the pleasure that we are put in place as a church, the Catholic has not gotten to the level that we are expecting it to be. At the same time, it cannot be denied that we have been patronizing a lot of social events. So our faith should manifest in the kind of zeal that we come to the house of God to worship. And our faith should also manifest in the kind of life that we lead as Christians. 2 Corinthians 5:17, that we know that one is in Christ is a new creation, and the old things have passed away, everything has become new. Once we have accepted Christ as our Lord and Savior, once we believe in the supremacy of God, our life starts to prevail. After all, in Antioch, in some of the people around chapter 10, that we are followers of Christ, for their lifestyle, the beauty of Christ in them, helping us people to believe that these people might have been followers of the Christ who was crucified. So wherever we find ourselves, in our families, our own wives, our own husbands, our own children, are the best to testify about the newness of Christ in us, and we should not be found wanting. Because the reality is that when humanity has an encounter with divinity, there is a new incarnation. You are able to move from the incarnation of wickedness, the incarnation of treachery, the incarnation of evil, to that incarnation of righteousness. And this must manifest in every aspect of your life. If we have had an encounter with this book, then it should also manifest in the way we give. And I like the testimony Paul gave about the Macedonian church in 2 Corinthians 8:1-5. In his letter to the Corinthians, Paul gave to them the amount of grace bestowed on the churches of Macedonia in giving. That was Paul's own testimony. He spoke about the grace of the church. So it's one thing having it and another having the grace to give. You may pile up a lot of things, but if you are not blessed with the grace to give, no amount of announcements, no amount of appeals, no amount of admonition will cause you to be. So let us pray to ask for the grace to give. And one of the testimonies of Paul about the Corinthian church, about the Macedonian church, which he told the Corinthians, was that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy in their deep poverty abounded in the riches of their liberality. In other words, they gave freely in the midst of their poverty, trials, and afflictions. And they gave according to their ability and beyond their ability, and were freely willing to give. They implored Paul and the other believers with him with much urgency to receive the gift of the fellowship and the fellowship of the ministry to the saints. Apart from the desire to give, they needed Paul to allow them to give. If there had been a situation in which we have covered, in which we have this pandemic, we would have looked for excuses to be exempted from giving. But in the midst of their affliction, they were rather begging the man of God that they reached that with the fall, they should allow to give it because the work of God. But what about their seeking? Their seeking was because they had already given themselves the call I've been talking about. If you really give your life to Christ, you see yourself as a student. Whatever you have, whatever situation, you know that it is God who has made things possible for you. And therefore, you don't need to be coerced, you don't need to be put under pressure, you don't need to be persuaded. You know where you are coming from, you know where you were, and how God delivered you from your situation. And that in itself alone serves as a motivation for you to give to God. In a time of great trial of affection, it is possible to remain steadfast or committed in the midst of trials. That is a lesson we can learn from the Macedonian example. We also learn that in the specific matter of giving, a child of God can continue to give to the Lord even when he or she is facing trials. We can also give in the midst of COVID pandemic, which is worse in a century. In the midst of affliction, there is an abundant joy. It sounds incredible to talk about joy in the midst of affliction, but the Macedonian brethren have confidence that it is possible, James 1, 2, and 3. And despite their deep poverty, they give free. It's one thing having to give, and another willing to give free. Giving has nothing to do with the amount of wealth we have accumulated, the heart in which we are given matters wisdom. In Luke 2, 21-3, Jesus commended a poor widow who dropped the last 2 minutes into the offering bowl for having been more than Paul. He went beyond the power of ability. And what we learn from this is that giving should not be seen as a sort of competition with others, because what is acceptable is what pleases Paul. In spite of their financial challenges, he gave free or willingly by exemplifying the teaching of 2 Corinthians 9:7, that giving should not be done by the way or necessity for God loves the children. They basically meant to be allowed to have part in contributing to public causes. They implored Paul and other believers to conserve their funds. They had a very good justification for begging Paul to be exempted from giving, but would rather beg him to be allowed to participate in this contribution of the poor among the saints. He gave their life, told you already, that was the secret. Therefore, when we also give our right to help us, we not become very difficult for us to give treaties, time, treasure, and talents. Reward of faithfulness. In the central scheme of things, the world is not fair to people who have served in numerous ways of life. While we normally see it has to do with voluminous tributes which are read in memory of the dead, but when they are alive, the good things they do are written on water, who takes no time to wash away. And the bad things are the things that are written on grass, so that they will remain forever. So in the worldly scheme of things, there is a lot of unfairness. But in the scheme of God, God recognizes whatever we do and rewards us. We read about the Joseph, we read about the Abraham's, even though the promise about the Holy City, they did not need to see that one day to live in that great war, they died in the hope and anticipation that one day, what God promised will manifest. So as believers, we are not looking at what we see in the physical. But we are encouraged by the fact that we shall not be eluded finally by the Lord. Because God is a faithful God who watches over his way to perform. Therefore, we believe that we are going to live by his way. But the promise of our faith in when we die, what we inherit in eternity. And even before we go, we'll have a foretaste of what is ours in the final or in the ultimate analysis. The best that mortal man does is to appreciate, to appreciate is to have the luminous tools to be at memorials and as discovered on purpose to most honor people who will not be living to receive. But the God that we are talking about is not like that. We have talked about the Old Testament examples, and I really want to call you much with those things. I'll move straight to what the encounter that woman had with Jesus Christ, and which was the text. The text we are taking it from Matthew 15:28, and for purposes of the passage, I want to repeat. Dear woman, Jesus said to her, your faith is great, your request is granted, and her daughter was instantly healed. We are told in the scripture, which was read, and the inference that we can make, one of the inferences is that there is a positive correlation between the magnitude of our faith and the reward that grew with it. Because Jesus himself testified about the woman that your faith is great, and therefore your request has been granted. What can we say about this? The woman was inhibited by several factors, but she persisted in her faith. One, she was a Gentile. And Gentiles and Jews, they had a problem. There were some of the Jews who didn't believe that Gentiles could become true Christians without following the Mosaic law or being circumcised. That alone would have prohibited the woman from getting to Jesus. But she did not allow that to become a burden. We are told that when the woman begged Jesus Christ for mercy, there was absolute silence. Jesus did not respond. Then the disciples saw her as a nuisance, and they prevailed on their master to sack the woman because she was becoming a problem. The woman remained committed to what she was looking for. But mind you, she had already referred to Jesus as Lord. She had already referred to Jesus as Lord. So it means she had faith in that Jesus. And what happened again? The first time Jesus spoke, he said, I have been sent only to the Jews. I am agent for the Jews. This way he calls whatever prejudices the woman might have, but that did not discover the woman. Jesus again said, it is not good to give what belongs to the children to dogs. Then the woman said, Master, I know. And when the master eats, the dogs are also called to pick the grass from under the tree. And that was what caused Jesus to admit that the faith was great. And we are told that instantly, the problem that the woman sent to Jesus, when the child or the daughter was demonized, there was an immediate solution to that. When the woman persisted in her faith, she had an answer. And mind you, it would have even been difficult for the woman to say that to God, that my daughter is demonized. It happened in public. Some of us have a problem with that. We feel too big to declare Jesus as our Lord. We feel too big to be born again because of our titles and names and the kind of social family and status that is attributed to us. This woman defied all odds. Jesus sounded very insulting and very repulsive, but that will not put the woman away. I don't know what you are asking for. I don't know what your challenge is. I don't know what has become an abacus around your head. But mind you, it was the disciples who wanted their master to drive the woman away. There are people who think they have the prerogative in the house of God to decide who to become born again. It is only Jesus Christ. Let me encourage you that do not be discouraged by what anybody is doing in the church. Salvation is not from the minister. Salvation is not from the steward. Salvation is not from the pastor. It is about Jesus Christ. And when the woman persisted, there was a solution. So what is it has become a problem? And I believe that this man had a chance to give as an accusation, she would have given all that she had. I don't know where you are coming from, but I know where I am coming from. I have been told about my history. My mother used to tell me that I was the ugliest among all my sons. We were eight. Because I was born a premature baby 52 years ago in a village where I was born. I went to school barefooted as a school prefect. But today, here am I. I don't need any prophet or anyone to tell me about that book because I am a witness to what it has done in my life. And that motivates me to be my best goal. So in a moment, I understand that we are in a crisis. I will not want you to build a person. What would it be? At least there is one thing you can also remember in your life. What is it that you remember? What is it that you remember? And what was the situation you were born in your life? I have to repeat many schools with a distinction, but there was nobody to look after me in the same place. Can you believe? It is only people who have to make money with you in it. But I think the whole world that have been the first one to have repeated with a distinction. I didn't give up. And today when I tell my story, if you were not for the reason that there were people who are not going to be still testify, people might even take it as a situation. But I thank God my shoulders to it. They are all alive. And they will corroborate what I have realized I am here. So that alone motivates me to give my best to God. I don't need any money. So what are you also doing? What are you doing? I told you earlier on that there is a positive correlation between the magnitude of faith that you have and the reward. Because the woman persisted and her faith was born. And if it is about giving and his relationship to God and say, Luke 6:38 says that give and it shall be given back unto you. A good measure that is pressed down and shaped and overflowed will be put into your bosom. So, better is to me. See, sometimes out of your zeal for the Lord, you can tackle a venture and it will become a reputation. I've said before that Elijah, out of his zeal for the Lord, made a reputation of the craft of me. He did that to challenge him, who was a father. And when the reputation came, he became a victim of his own prophecy. But because he did that out of his zeal for the Lord, God made a special provision for him. We decided to build a church hall. We prayed over it. The leaders, the clergy, the church, we all agreed and we decided to build up a church hall. Today, it has become an abattoir. Did we make a mistake? No. We did that out of the zeal that we had for the Lord. And we are looking at God in his own wisdom. We use all of us here to pay that debt off. And we'll have a testimony to share. I believe that. Because I know it's possible that one day someone will run here and tell each other, I want to take over. I will pay the debt to the bank. It will be between me and the church and pay it at the own place without any interest. I know it's a prophecy that I'm making and it will come to pass. I know somebody here is capable of doing that. So let us continue to pray. And the longer that we can afford, let us give it. Lord will not make us ashamed. And finally, does it mean that when our faith is small, it means we have nothing to do? No. Jesus said that even if your faith is as small as a mustard seed, you can cause mountains to move. And therefore, it doesn't matter how small it is. But if there is an opportunity to even nurture your faith, you can nurture it. It goes beyond accepting Christ as your Savior. Beyond that, you have to be regular in church attendance. Beyond that, you have to read your Bible. Beyond that, you need to pray. Beyond that, you have to emulate the actionable faith people are exercising in church. Before you are aware, your faith will also go. And the commensurate reward will not be diluted. It is my prayer that the Holy Spirit, who convicted us unto the saving of the Lord Jesus Christ, will give us the grace to give our treasure, our time, and talent, so that the Lord, who is a rewarder, will also reward us according to the riches in his glory. Let us thank God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Shall we pray? Thank you for bringing us all this far. Thank you for your mercy. Pray that, Father, when as you are speaking to us, who meditate upon it day and night, make a conscious effort through the enablement of the Holy Spirit to put it into practice, so that we shall receive the reward that goes to them. We know we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. We give you the praise and honor and adoration in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray with us. Amen.
Understanding, rest and abide with you and your families now.